Welcome back to the Business of Government Hour. I'm Michael Keegan, your host, and our guest today is Kathy Stack, advisor for evidence-based innovation at the Office of Management and Budget. So, Kathy, the federal fiscal situation necessitates improvement in efficiencies for government programs. And as you said earlier, one of the ways we're trying to do that is through evidence-based analysis and program evaluation. And, you know, we're inundating in this context a lot of terms that folks may not be familiar with. And what I want to talk about is sort of that evidence infrastructure. And in two specific tools, performance management and measurement and program evaluation. Could you tell us what they are and how, when you put them in place, do you create a culture of continuous feedback and improvement?
So performance measurement is really thinking about what's the process that you're going to use to try to get to the result that you know you're supposed to be achieving. It's an art, looks at inputs, process measures, outputs, outcomes, in order to manage programs, set goals, continually improve performance, looking at day-to-day operations and are you on track. It's really well suited to dashboards where you're looking at your performance over time on different indicators. That can be very, very valuable information because when you see something's off track, you say, okay, let's stop, let's get everybody together, figure out how do we course correct. Mm-hmm. And that's, frankly, every organization needs to use performance measurement as a management tool. And I think, unfortunately, there's a lot of performance measurement going on in government where we've got people who are reporting out on indicators that were decided on 10 years ago, and there they are churning out the reports. They're not managing the data to make sure they're improving. Now, evaluation answers different questions. And if you think of a program as, hey, we've got a lot of different strategies that are going on here. In my particular world, we did a lot with grant programs, where if you think about grant programs, they're supporting a wide range of different strategies. And you're trying to figure out which one of these or which collection of these is really having the greatest impact on outcomes and in ways that we would know that if we didn't have this program, we wouldn't be getting those results. So setting up controlled experiments and comparison groups where you can really see whether option A, let's take a reading curriculum. We've got a range of reading curriculums that back in the 80s and 90s, we had lots of people claiming that some worked better than others. We had wars going on between those who believed in phonics and those who believed in whole language. And fortunately, we had a strong child development center over at NIH that was able to go in and do controlled experiments on reading approaches and discovered that, you know what, this phonics-based approach does seem to be getting better impacts because they could set it up through randomization of the students. And those findings were just so powerful that they enabled there to be political coalitions that formed around, let's drive more dollars to where the evidence says we should spend them.
So how important is it, so you have these two tools, and they do different things, but how important is it to bridge the divide between these tools so you get the advantage of the synergy that you get from both of them working together?
It's essential, and there aren't that many places where we're doing it well. New York City set up the Center for Economic Opportunity, and it was set aside a pot of $100 million or so, and they were charged with coming up with a portfolio of strategies that were going to be able to make a measurable difference in reducing poverty in New York City. They're using data all the time to see how are we doing, which providers are doing better, and the providers that aren't doing well, they get let go. But the city is also working with some very, very strong research firms like MDRC, bringing them in on some of the interventions that they think could have the greatest impact and perhaps the greatest cost effectiveness, but they want to demonstrate it. They want to have that rigorous analysis to know, is this really getting the results we want enough so that we should be investing more money and scaling it up? Mm-hmm. And it's those high-stakes decisions where that rigorous evaluation is just really important in telling you whether you're getting the results well enough for a population compared to what they could get under some alternative that you want to go big.
So, Kathy, because federal dollars flow to states and localities and other entities through competitive grants and formula grants, grant reform is an important component for strengthening the use of evidence in government. I understand the most exciting advancement in this area is called tiered evidence or innovation fund grant designs. Would you tell us more about these designs, and what does it mean for a grant program to have a tiered evidence design?
Sure. So this actually started under the Bush administration with a small $10 million home visiting program that the President Bush included in his 2010 budget on home visiting, where we realized that, hey, if we provided an incentive in our grant programs for applicants to come in with the strongest possible evidence to show us that a particular strategy was ready to be scaled up because it had strong random control trials or quasi-experiments to support it, that maybe we could change the dynamic in the incentive structure. Mm-hmm. What this administration did is they translated that concept into a tiered design. And I'll give you an example that is one of my favorites at the Education Department. It's the Investing in Innovation Fund. Mm-hmm. And the way the Investing in Innovation Fund is structured, it's a program that provides grants for K-12 educational innovations. But we have different levels of investment in three different tiers. First, there is a scale-up tier where applicants can get up to $20 million, but they have to bring in project proposals that are backed by the strongest possible evidence. Mm-hmm. Random control trials, strong quasi-experiments, multiple studies that basically give us as taxpayers confidence that this has been shown to work in enough places with sufficiently strong results that if we invest a lot of money in it, that's a good investment. We're likely to get results elsewhere. Then we have a next tier of validation grants and education's program. These are grants of up to $12 million. So it's less money for promising practices with moderate evidence. Our bottom tier is called development grants. They're grants of up to $3 million. And these require really, really exciting proposals with strong potential, but they don't have to have that extensive evidence backing. They do, at all of these levels, have to have a strong evaluation design so that as we are making these investments, we're continuing to learn whether or not they're having impact. And the goal, ultimately, is for things in the development tier, if they're successful, they should move up to the validation tier and the scale-up tier and eventually be incorporated into the base formula programs in the sense that states and localities know what works and they can replicate these strategies in their own funding streams.
So traditional grant programs, what are some of the limitations associated with traditional grant programs that the tiered design approach can ameliorate?
The tiered approach really creates the incentives for people in the projects and the applicants on the front end to look at the research, and it also creates the incentives for them to become partners in building evidence by partnering with researchers and evaluators to say, how can we structure our activities, embed an evaluation within what we're doing so we can help build this base? And if our project works and shows that it has impact, you know, it lands somewhere in the What Works clearinghouse. Mm-hmm. And if it doesn't work, well, we have evidence that it didn't work, and that's useful too.
I'd like to talk about the new authority for performance partnership pilots for disconnected youth, which was recently, as I understand it, included in the 2014 Omnibus Appropriations Bill. What was the impetus for this, and how will it work?
So this is one of the most exciting examples that I can think of bottoms-up policymaking. The genesis for this was in February of 2011, the president issued a memorandum to agencies calling on finding administrative flexibility for states, localities, and tribes. And it was a charge to agencies to go seek input from states and localities about what are the barriers, what's getting in your way. One of the most compelling examples that emerged from that was put together by a coalition of states working with the Forum for Youth Investment, looking at the population of disconnected youth. There are kids, 14 up through early 20s, who are out of school, mm-hmm. dropped out, and don't have jobs.
Okay.
And the reality is that we have dozens of federal funding streams, youth-serving programs, that could touch them. Mm-hmm. But the way they are structured, it's incredibly difficult for a locality to make those services work together. And in the president's 2013 budget, he proposed some bold pilots allowing up to 13 communities to blend their funding, mm-hmm. taking dollars from these multiple funding streams, putting them into one pot, and creating an outcome-focused strategy where they would negotiate with the federal government, the multiple agencies, and the state partners on a new approach, a set of outcome measures and key indicators that they would track, but then stripping away all of the unnecessary, unproductive work. So it turns out we got that authority in the 2014 appropriations bill. And I think the reason we got it, frankly, the administration never met with the Congress to discuss it. It was the states who had brought forward the ugly picture, who presented the ugly picture to the key members on the Hill. And that's how it landed in the bill.
Interesting. So, Kathy, I was wondering, what is an evidence-based framework or an evidence framework? How do you use it? And what can agencies do to develop one?
So an evidence framework is just a tool mm-hmm. for distinguishing between preliminary, moderate, and strong evidence. And it sets the standards for telling applicants which bucket do you fit in. But it has broader applicability, really, to almost all grant programs and a lot of other federal programs. If you think about anything you're doing, there's a continuum of evidence. There's things that you know work, and the more evidence you have, especially if you have random control trials showing that this approach had better impacts, that's going to be at the top of the continuum, the top tier. But you're always developing new ideas, new approaches, and that's going to be near the bottom of that continuum. So a program manager can really think about everything they're doing in a grant program, for instance, and say, which of the projects that I'm supporting fit? They all fit somewhere on this evidence continuum, but chances are, in most of our federal programs, most projects are going to be down near the bottom because we've never required them to produce evidence through rigorous evaluations that they're making a difference. So the goal over time in all of our activities should be, let's know where we sit on the evidence continuum and let's create all the incentives and tools possible so that things can move up. And when we get near the top, we really have confidence that if we direct more dollars to those things, we'll see results.